I wonder how many people would come back the next Sunday if he's preaching like this all the time. Wash your hands, you sinner, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. So there's a couple levels, right? The level, wash your hands, that's the act that we do. Then purifying my heart has to do with dealing with my thought life, my attitude, right? And much of our activity in any realm as a Christian deals with thought, word, and deed. And there's the issue that sins or transgressions, or in this way, selfish ambition and all these things really happens in your thought life, then you can get some signals about how we talk to and about one another, and then we can get some real clue about how we act, right? James also talked about the power of the tongue. In this book, he didn't say what is so popular now, that your words have power and just speak this thing and faith and this and that. No, he said, no, watch how you talk, because it's a shame that you encourage and bless God on one hand and then you bite and devour each other on the other. Yeah, how is it that this impurity comes out of one side of your mouth and then there comes forth the blessing and the glory of God? How is it that he began to talk about this tongue guiding your life, and he's talking about how I use words in the context of relationships, like the song said. You heard it, you sang it, I need you to survive. I won't harm you with words from my mouth, they were singing. Well, that song was basically the writer was paraphrasing several passages from Colossians, Ephesians, and from this book of James that could have been almost a verbatim quote. So we're at this unique place that I need to understand that I've got to watch how I talk and interact with folk. Let's go back to verse 8 of chapter 4. Are you still with me? Wash your hands, you sinners. Purify your hearts, you double-minded. Now, he takes in verse 9 another level deeper. First, I got to recommend to you that you examine the impact of my attitude on my broken relationships. My attitude, I'm not going to be able to bring reconciliation or get certain relationships healed unless I begin to take the low place, the humble place, and to take ownership that it's my attitude that's causing me to be disconnected, at least part of this major problem. Y'all still with me? My attitude. Then as I look at my attitude, then it says, grieve, mourn, and wail. Change your laughter to mourning and your joy to gloom. We talked about the psychology of change in times past. I think this is very important. At some place, if I'm not going to repeat this trap I may be getting into in a certain area, I got to see it the way God sees it. I mean, can't rationalize this thing that away, these problems away that I'm having perhaps with my brother or a family member over a long period of time. Recently, a friend of mine had a death in the family, and one of the quote-unquote considered favorite children flew back home to try to settle the estate of their loving departed parent. And before the trip was over, they got into a big hassle about what did you do with this bank account, this, that, and the other, and there was all kind of interaction, friction there. And the question is, did this competition and struggle in the family just begin? Probably not. So someone was there, and so I got to own my attitudes, own my issues, own my part of it, if I'm going to now reconcile with somebody, even a family member. Wow, I've got to take a look at myself. And what he's saying is, don't start pointing the finger. We know they have a problem, but you can't fix their problem. You can only address your issues.